on our data for Italy and Germany. So the pale blue is the mezzo giorno in percent, and also we've got GDP per capita here from 1913 up to 2013. So it's kind of interesting. You can see that we just have this very long sweep. The weight of trade within employment is much lower in the South than it is in some more data. This is data about competitiveness. Again, this is going to be a theme in what I'm going to talk about. This is the Italy on the left, Germany on the right. Just look first of all at the black line. So the black line shows you unit labor costs in Mezzogiorno relative to the center north. There's no, essentially no trend. So unit labor costs went up in Italy, they went up in the south as well as in the north over the period from 1919. This is the story in Germany for exactly the same period. So look at the black. East Germany's costs relative to the west fell dramatically. Okay, so this is 100, this is 50. Okay, so this is a very dramatic development in competitiveness. And you might just keep in mind what's happening with the unit labor costs in West Germany, and think about the situation in Italy, and that's going to come back when we move from the country level to talking about the north and the south of the Eurozone. Here we've got trade shares. The trade share of East Germany increasing strongly over the periods of gentrification, having started about the same level as the Mezzogiorno. Okay, this is the trade share of the Mezzogiorno. And something else that I want to highlight is the difference between these regions in their specialization. So this is exports of chemicals, machinery, and equipment as a percent of total exports. So this is the Mezzogiorno down here, very low specialization in these categories of exports and a declining share in its total exports over the period. This is Germany, West Germany is the black, East Germany up here is the grey. There's all sorts of interesting things in these data that we don't really have time to discuss, but I'm sure you're thinking about this interesting collapse in the crisis that was very characteristic of Germany. But anyway, we can come back to it. You can find interesting things that you can somehow relate to what I'm talking about, and we'll come back to them later on. Okay, so that gives you a very, I hope, a sort of snapshot of the two different countries and the different position of the regions within those two countries in terms of trade goals. So I want to just refer to this very famous paper by Franklin and Homer, which provided a clever way of identifying the econometrically, the causal relationship between engagement in international trade and growth. Applying the same methodology to the regional level, so international trade by different regions in Germany and Italy, we find that again that international trade shares pretty cheap per capita in both those countries. Regions with higher trade shares have higher GDP. In both countries, the effect of a given trade share on GDP is weaker in the weaker region, so it's beginning to reinforce this idea that trade, and here international trade, matters for convergence. But in Germany, once we control for the trade share, the trade share interacted with the dummy from being the eastern part of the country, then the dummy for East Germany is positive. So we're progressing per capita at the regional level on essentially trade variables and an indicator of whether the region is in the east or the west. When we do the same thing for Italy, we get a dummy for the south is negative. So this is underlining the fact that international trade matters for growth, that weak regions benefit less from international engagement than stronger regions, so that's true for both countries. But the controlling for this trade, international trade disadvantage, East Germany's GDP per capita is a little different, predictably little different from that of Western regions. And the opposite is true for Italy. So let me just turn to the exactly the wrong kinds of industries at the moment that the first oil shock was about to hit. So Petrojana, as you will be familiar, remains heavily dependent on transfers, and the estimate suggests that it's received about 30% of its GDP from the north for more than 50 years. Okay, so this is the Italian story. So why did we push policy effort in the 1960s to take pollution to sustain growth? What are the weak institutions, culture, and why do they exist? Let's do the same kind of exercise in the German case. Political and economic integration is a very similar time. As I mentioned, when we look at the data, the territories that form east and west Germany after the Second World War were essentially very similar. Okay, you want to ask the same question about history. When was the south and the north of Italy at the same level of GDP per capita? Anyone know the answer? Yes, a long time ago. Yeah. So in other words, in the earliest data that there appeared, that the economic historians have constructed, that seems to be the case in the 19th century, but as soon as they started measuring it, divergence began. Okay, you began on that path that I showed you in the data. To mention the trade element of the German story, the central planning included the planning of trade. But it's essentially imposed over Turkey on East Germany during the period. So the rules of the game were to change, if you ever wanted to see the changing rules, that this is a good case to look at. Planning prevented East Germany from closing the gap in GDP per capita, and in some other work I've done, East Germany fits the pattern, which is that if you had a relatively high level of GDP per capita and you got central planning, then you lost out relative to your market economy peers. If you had a relatively low level of GDP per capita and you got planning, then you did well relative to your market economy peers. And the explanation for that is in the title, which is Soviet power plus electrification. I could have said electrification plus education. It's really the explanation. So moving swiftly on, this is just the data that shows East Germany experienced divergence during the planning period. So East Germany was once this successful, sophisticated, industrialized region. The question is, why has it not converged fully to West German levels, in spite of massive policy intervention and common reform institutions? Will it be a measure drawn on like the Italian South? So the short zip to the conclusion is we don't completely understand the answer to the first question, but I'm fairly convinced, and possibly will be, that the answer to the second question is no. So the third of our case is the Eurozone. We know the story about integration in Europe, and that from 2010 the Eurozone has been in crisis. So this is the picture I showed you before, rapid convergence between the north and south of the Eurozone from the 1960s to the 1990s. Okay, up here. Very rapid in the first period, and then slowly. But then from, there seems to be a sharp break in the mid-2000s, and rapid divergence followed with the crisis. So this is very stark indication of the story of the north and the south under conditions of market integration. major river appreciation, the North River appreciation, and then just spring out some of the countries to show in more detail.
Those are given the euros,
basically? Yeah, that doesn't matter. Therefore, they require transparent words just use ordinary routine eyes like they were. This there's been a kind of flowering of research in economics using extremely detailed data on the characteristics of the kinds of contracts that are involved in the production of different kinds of goods. And these are the data that are presented here that show a relationship between a measure of trust on the horizontal axis and comparative advantage in routine intensive goods. Okay, so that the higher the measure of trust, then so within the context of a game, an imaginary game setup, if the individuals conforming to the status quo institutions, remember there are two of these things, conforming to status quo institutions and cultural norms in a mutual best response, then that's a reason for the inferior convention to persist. So what do I mean by institution? This is the employment relationship. So if the employer chooses management decision-making institution, it's got two, the management has two choices, either the works council arrangement, which provides autonomy to workers, or a top-down authoritarian management structure. So we just create a very simple split at this time. In terms of the workers' responses, they can respond either with the cultural norm of cooperation, so just think of it in the context of Volkswagen and Fiat. So the first thing is that the firm chooses the management contract, and then the worker responds to the contract either cooperatively or resistance, and these are the two stable equilibria. Yeah. Okay. So very simple setup. The superior convention is the northern convention. This enables the production of the opaque good. The inferior convention only allows the production of the transparent routine good. Okay, so here we have some nice tip from the International Times, which just gives you some sense of what happened over the period from 2000 to 2012. This is car production in Western Europe. So Germany's share went up from 30 to 44%. Italy's went down from 10 to 5%. And a very similar story with, you can see, from profits. Now we have one simple diagram to illustrate the story of comparative advantage. So this is the transparent route here, which only uses standard labour. This is the opaque route here. The north, okay, the north has an absolute advantage in both routes, but it has a comparative advantage in the opaque route. So this is the north here. The north can produce more of both, and the comparative advantage is in the opaque route. So what do we predict? Very, very simple model. We predict complete specialization. So the north only produces the opaque grid and the south specializes in the transparent grid. So what's the conclusion of the model? If we've got otherwise identical regions or countries where we have this cultural or institutional diversity, then this provides the basis of comparative advantage matches the institutional convention, and greater integration produces more specialization. So that's really the three steps. So it's the specialization and integration reinforces the specialization according to your particular convention. So what's the kind of evidence that this way of thinking about integration is insightful for the three cases that I Italian case has been very extensively studied. Different institutions and culture, the ecosystem in the south. The quote from Republican, I think, is a very well-known quote, which just characterizes in his terms, in social capital terms, but we can think of it much more broadly, that the center north has this dense network of local associations, active engagement in community affairs, egalitarian politics, trust, law abidingness, and then you just turn around all of those descriptive terms to characterize the culture and institutions itself. So the argument is that resistance to catch-up seems embedded in the societal differences. How did this emerge, given that these two parts of the country were initially at similar levels of GDP per capita? Well, there's just a conjecture. This is obviously something about which economic historians should have a lot to say, and I think it's a very interesting question to pursue, which is the idea that industrialization sharing the funds and trails. Was this to do with the massive Germany, it's, they're spread around, there are three imperial cities in both the east and the west. In terms of early establishment of universities, it's concentrated in the north of Italy, that was spread around in Germany. And in the early industrialization, you can actually see that in the 19th century, the share of economic industry was higher in the east than the west. What about contemporary indicators? I told you about the behavior of experiments that show that there's still more cheating in East Germany than in West Germany, but the comparison between Italy and Germany is very stark. When you take voluntary work, okay, this is 50%, roughly half that of the center north, much higher proportions in East Germany relative to the West. Shadow economy, I think that's pretty, this is unsurprising. In organ donations, some people think of as the best kind of measure of trust, objective measure, then in East Germany it's actually higher than it is in the West. Back to Frank Roma from with this background. East Germany and Mesa Germany clearly appear to be very different. If we control the persistent problem in trade wars, okay, we saw that turnaround in the share of employment in trade wars, but there's still a gap. East Germany's per capita GDP is predicted to be higher than West Germany's. This is not the case, so it's a very clean separation in the analysis. But this is not the case in Italy. So let me turn in the last few minutes to the final example, to talk about the Eurozone. The continuation of the kind of argument I've been making is that it's through mutual trust and a shared understanding of the rules of the game in the currency union that firms and workers in the north, and particularly in Germany, negotiated wage and productivity deals to deliver a sustainable exchange rate. So the real exchange rate is not the whole story of the Eurozone crisis, but it's part of the story. And it's the part of the story that links to the mechanisms that I'm drawing attention to. Adversarial industrial relations, it's the absence of trust and shared understanding, prevented the necessary adaptation to the very new rules of the game that came along with being a member of the monetary union. And it's hardly necessary to say this, but just to note that in standard macroeconomic modelling, like the Keynesian models, Galli Monticelli, for example, ignore institutions and they simply assume immediate adjustment by all parties to the new rules of the game. And this was a bad idea when thinking about what was likely to happen under conditions of monetary integration in Europe. So this is a decomposition of the labor cost data, which showed that it was both nominal wages growing faster, so this is 1999. Okay. Nominal wages growing faster in the south and productivity growing more slowly. So it's both on the side of the inability to achieve the required coordination over nominal wage setting and to achieve the required behavioral response. Faster, given that that was the period of convergence. Okay, so as we are well aware, that's not possible. So that all the adjustment to any kind of shock, or all the adjustment required for a catch-up process, has to take place through wages, prices, and productivity. And we have clear differences in wage setting institutions between the North and the South of Europe. Wage setting in Germany is a mechanism through which the real exchange rate can be targeted. There were, from the late 1990s, flexible deals were negotiated over hours, training, investment between managers and works councils to target the real exchange rate. Okay, these were the new rules of the game in Germany. Lost competitiveness, that allows a different form of space.